about 6-8 months ago, Pastor Jamie asked me, he's like, Brent, as an elder, I think you need to start preaching. And I'm like, no, you got this. That's not me. So over the holidays, doing my devotions, and I felt like God was saying, no, Brent, you need to start preaching. I'm like, no, that's Jamie's job. And it kept coming and kept coming. So Jamie and I meet on a regular basis. So the next time I'm like, Jamie, you know, 6 months ago when you asked me if I wanted to preach, and I said no, well, I think God's convicted me to preach. He was like, good, because we were going to talk about that this morning. So that was confirmation. So, you know, out of my exuberance, I know what my first sermon is going to be. Something in 1 John. I got this beautiful passage I love. Jamie, I'm going to do this. Brent, I'm doing a series on Psalms. Now, if you remember a couple weeks ago when Jamie was introducing the Psalms, and he's like, the Psalms are poetry and beautiful, and I don't want to hear you guys saying, oh, poetry, they're all macho. Guilty. For those of you who know me, I don't do Psalms. It's poetry. So God has a sense of humor. I didn't want to preach, and I didn't want to do Psalms, so I'm going to preach, and I'm going to start out with Psalms. So with that as a background, and being my first time, I need all the help I get, so we're going to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you this morning, and I humbly just ask for your provision. I ask, Lord, that your words and only your words would come out of my mouth. I confess to you that I'm terrified for doing this because I have to rightfully divide your word. And I also confess, Lord, I've been looking forward to this because I get to proclaim your word. And for that, I thank you. I ask that you have receptive hearts. I pray against the birds of the air that wants to peck away the seeds, Lord. And I just pray, Lord, where everybody is here, that through your words that they would want to come closer and closer to you and have a deeper relationship. And that's my desire in the name of Jesus. So I have chosen Psalm 51, and it's a psalm of repentance. And a psalm of repentance. I think of verses like, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus, and you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. We often think of repentance when we come to Jesus. But do you know, in throughout the Bible, there's more said about repentance to the church or people of God than there are sinners. And so that's a heavy load. When you look at in the book of Revelation, the seven churches, he told five of the seven, you need to repent from what you're doing. So repentance is important for us as believers. And, let's just start out. I'm going to read through this, and then we're going to tear it down, not verse by verse, but very closely. It's a little longer than we usually do. So some areas I'm going to skip over, but there's a main point I want to get to. This is either going to go really fast, and we can beat the Baptist to the restaurants, or we'll just see how long God has us to go. Okay. Psalm 51. To the choir master, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet went to him after he had gone into Bathsheba. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltness. O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. So that is the background. Well, we need to go to the background. That's the psalm that David wrote, as the beginning said, when he went into Bathsheba. So what's that all about? So we need to go back and look what David did with David and Bathsheba. And then what Nathan the prophet. So David, he's the king of Israel. He was the second king. And the word says that David was a man after God's own heart. You know, we think of David, and he was the one that slew the giant, and a man that conquered many of the armies, and a mighty man. And like I said, a God after his own heart. So what did David do that was so grievous that God sent Nathan to rebuke him, and that he wrote this beautiful psalm of repentance? That we can find that in 2 Samuel, verse 11, chapter 11. I've got a lot of scripture in mind, and I got most of it up here. I said most. I will tell you the other ones. As I go through this, I just want you to look at the scripture. I don't want you to believe it because I'm saying it. I want you to go back and read the scriptures for yourself and be convinced yourself what God is saying. So let's look at what David did that was bad. In the spring of the year, in the time when kings go out to battle, David sent Joab and his servants with him and all of Israel. And they ravaged the Amorites and besieged Rabbah. But David remained at Jerusalem. It happened late one afternoon, when David arose from his couch and was walking on the roof of the king's house, that he saw from a roof a woman bathing, and the woman was very beautiful. And David sat and inquired about the woman, and one said, "Is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" So David sent messengers and took her, and she came to him, and he lay with her. Now she had been purifying herself from her uncleanliness. Then she returned to her house, and the woman conceived, and she sent and told David, "I am pregnant." Now, further on, I'm just going to kind of summarize. But when we look at this, he saw this beautiful woman, he wanted her, he called for her, and she came because he was the king. And Uriah, her husband, David knew Uriah. It tells us later in 2 Samuel that Uriah, her husband, was a mighty, mighty man. And the mighty men of David were his warriors. You might call him David's SEAL 6 team, or you know what I'm trying to say. So, and it also was the daughter of Eliam. Eliam, in other scriptures, was a prominent man. So David knew this family. And so it was a friend of his. And he did this grievous thing. It goes on to tell us, to cover his sin, God called Uriah from the battlefield. Remember, they're out in battle. And he said, "Hey, Uriah, how's it going? How's the battle going? Are my men being taken care of?" And he gave a report, and David expected him to go home, lie with his wife, and cover his sin. Well, it didn't happen. Uriah did not go home, and he stayed at the king's place, and the servants told that to David, and David's like, calls Uriah back. How come you didn't go home? Joab, which was the commander of the army, it's his four-star general, Joab is sleeping in the open fields, and all of Israel is sleeping in the open fields. Who am I to go home and have the comforts of home? So he didn't go home. He was being more righteous. So he's like, okay, stay another day. So David the next day said, come on over. He gave him a nice feast, gave him some drink, and intentionally got him drunk. And then expecting his drunkenness would go home and sleep with his wife and cover his sin. And Uriah was more righteous, and he didn't do it. So finally, in desperation, David sent a letter with Uriah to Joab, the commander, and told Uriah, well, gave the letter to Uriah and said, put Uriah at the very front of the battle and then withdraw your men so he would die. So think about it. Uriah was carrying his own death letter to Joab, the commander, and that's what happened. And you can read the full story. So, I just want to say, we don't need Netflix or HBO or any of this stuff. We have lies, we have deceit, we have rape, we have murder. It's all right here. And so this is the grievous thing that David did. But by context, we know he didn't repent. So, to further go on this story, 2 Samuel 11, verse 26, when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she lamented for her husband. And when the mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David done had displeased the Lord. Well, I would think so. So the Holy Spirit told Nathan, the prophet, one of the prophets at that time, to go and talk to David. And Nathan told David this nice little story. He told him a story of a rich man who had many lambs and many flocks and sheep. And then he told him of a poor man who was so poor he could afford one ewe lamb. And he bought this ewe lamb. And he cared for this ewe lamb as one of his family. The Bible says the lamb dined with him, and he had it like a pet, like we would have. And a traveler came to the area, and in that custom, they didn't have Holiday Inns back then. So if a prominent traveler was coming through, he would go through a prominent man's home and ask to be set up and set up for the night. And out of their hospitality, they would do that, and they would throw him a meal. Well, the rich man, out of his richness, didn't want to use his lamb, so he took the ewe lamb from this poor man and slaughtered it and served it. And this enraged David. David said, surely this man deserves to die. And Nathan said, David said to Nathan, oops, did I get ahead of myself? Okay, I don't have it on there. So David said, this man deserves to die. And then Nathan said, you are this man. You have killed your Uriah and taken his wife. So that is why he repented. Up to this point, and we'll see as we get into it, he hadn't repented. He was miserable over it, but he didn't admit it. So David repented of his sins in 2 Samuel. And David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord has put away your sin. You shall not die. So David was forgiven of what he had done, but he still had to live with the consequences. And there was something else I wanted to bring out. David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. Notice he said against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord has also put away your sin. You shall not die. Nevertheless, because this deed you have utterly scorned the Lord, the child who is born to you shall die. Then Nathan went to his house. So he still had to live with the consequences, and there's much more consequences in there, but I just wanted to get the highlights so we can see why David did this, wrote this psalm. So, with that as a background, we're going to look at a psalm of repentance. And I can break it down to three areas. You read the commentaries, they had them broken down to many areas. I just wanted to hit the three main areas. What is repentance? Well, repentance is going away into the opposite direction. Originally, it's actually a military term, to do a about face and go the opposite direction. Feeling sorry for your sins is not repentance. When you change what you did and go the other way, that is what true repentance is. And Psalm 51 gives us an outline of this repentance. And what we're going to look at, number one, as we look at it, is confession. You need to confess your sin to the Lord. Cleaning and restoration, after you confess it, God will clean you. And then after that, renewal and praise. We can't be used by God until we're cleansed, and then he will send us out to do it. So that's basically where we're going. And so let's start with confession. When he wrote, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. By doing this, David was admitting his guilt. So we have there, "Have mercy on me, blot out my transgressions." After Nathan came to him, he finally confessed it, said, "Yes, I did sin." So the first step of any repentance is recognizing your sin. How can you repent if you don't know what you're walking away from or doing the about face from? So you need to recognize your guilt, just as David recognized his guilt. And then he pleaded for mercy. Now, mercy is not receiving what you deserve. David deserved death. In the laws of that time, murder, you were to be killed. Adultery, you were to be killed. So David, by rights, should have been put to death by two accounts. But God didn't do that. So he received mercy. But in God's mercy, God forgave David's sin. God did not only forgive his sin, he blotted it out completely. Because he says, "According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgression." And when we look up that word, that means to wipe clean, to obliterate, to exterminate. So in God's eyes, when he asks for forgiveness, it's done. So the first thing he did was confess his sin. "Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression and my sin is ever before me." Well, when I read that, my transgression and my sin is ever before me. It's not on here, but that took me back to Genesis 4:7. If you want to write that down and look that up sometime. "For I know my transgression and my sin is ever before me." David recognized his state of sin. He recognized that he knew he was a sinner. And Genesis 4:7, this is Cain and Abel, but real quick, it gives you a good picture of sin. I love this word picture. It's when Cain was rejected by God because he did not give his first fruit offering with the right heart, and God rejected that, and he was mad about that. And the Lord, in verse 6, the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry, and why is your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must rule over it." I love that word picture because sin is crouching at the door. We walk out and sin is ready to pounce on us. In the world we live in, we're fallen creatures, but it also says, and it has its desire for you. Sin always wants to attack us, and we know that. but you must rule over it. As Christians, we must rule over it. I once had a wise older pastor tell me, he says, Brent, you need to have a plan before you go into battle. So you need to, and he's like, Brent, you need to decide in your heart now that you're going to be victorious over sin. When we walk out on the world or in our own home, and let's use example, surfing the internet, and something pops up that shouldn't, what do you do? You know in your heart now, I'm running. Because if you don't have that in your heart to begin with, you're going to fall to sin. So David understood this too when he said, I know my transgression, my sin is ever before me. So he knew that. Verse 4. Yeah, it's there. Yeah, it's there. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Our sin is ultimately against God. And remember when he said, I am that man, I did it, and against you I sinned. Even when he said that, he knew he sinned against God. David committed adultery against Bathsheba. David committed murder against Uriah. David had falsehood against all of Israel as the king. So, yes, he sinned against these people, but ultimately his sin and our sin is against God. We know the laws of God, as he knew. Nobody needs to tell us that you aren't to murder somebody. We know that. We don't need to be told not to commit adultery. We know that. So when we do that, it's ultimately against God. But, you know, I say, I've never committed adultery. I've never committed murder. But what does Jesus say against that? In Matthew 5:28, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman lustfully, with lustful intent, has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Remember, as I said a little while ago, you have to have your heart set in your heart that you're not going to sin. Your heart's where it always begins. And then further, it says in Matthew, I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable for judgment. So, looks like I've committed a murder and adultery. I've been mad at a brother without reason before. I would, if all men were honest, I think we would all say at one time we looked at the opposite sex with impure thoughts. So, I guess I'm a murderer and an adulterer too. So what do we do with that? So again, as David said, against you and you only have I sinned. And then finally, okay, this is where it was. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in them. God convicted David of his sin of adultery and murder. Against you and only you have I sinned. Again, the beginning of repentance is a confession of your sin. God already knows our sin. Hello? You're not telling God because he doesn't know. The confession is for ourselves. So we can only have healing when we recognize our rebellion against God. And then finally, what does David say at the end of verse 4? You may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge. Since I'm guilty, your judgment is correct. Remember what happened, though. God says your son will not live. Put yourself in David's. Yes, he committed this sin. Yes, he was sorry for it. But God says his son would not live, and God did take his son. And David could say, your judgment is correct. You were right in taking my son because I sinned. That's a heavy load. So, verse 5, Behold, I was brought forth in an iniquity, and in sin my mother did conceive me. David confesses he was born a sinner. We're also told that we're to approach God in the same way. Romans 3:23 tells us, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We need to confess we are sinners also. So this is the beginning of restoration. It was beginning of restoration for David, and it is the restoration for any person who needs to confess their sin. Verse 6, behold, you delight truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. We need to understand, as David understood, that our sinfulness originates in our heart, not our mind. It's your heart that convicts you. When you hear a good sermon, well, when you hear Jamie and a good sermon, do you think in your mind, wow, you know, I really need to stop doing that? Or no, you feel a burning in your heart, don't you? Your emotions start to well. The confession is in the heart. It's in the inward being. So when your heart is right, your mind and actions will follow also. So that's why David is asking for, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. So now that David confessed his sin, he can go on to being cleansed and restored. So cleansing and restoration. First we have confession, then we can go to restoration. And David further goes then, purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Now that one little word, hyssop, you know, we read that, okay, what does that mean? But to David and the Jewish reader, it had a very deep significance, and we need to talk about that. So, you know, simply, what is hyssop? Well, it's a plant in the mint family. And that plant traditionally has been used for medicinal purposes, and it also was used for religious ceremonies. And God used it in the ceremonies that he set up in Exodus. And it was a symbol of purification. In the Passover of Exodus chapter 12, 22, hyssop was the first time hyssop or hyssop was mentioned in the Bible. And in the Exodus, it says, take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and touch the lintel and the two doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. None of you shall go out of the door of this house until the morning. Now, what that was, the blood over the lintel before the Exodus was a symbol of covering by the blood of Jesus. And if you didn't have the blood over the lintel, when you go back and read in Exodus, when this is when God sent Moses to ask the Pharaoh to be released, and they had the whole set of plagues, you remember. The very last plague was death of the firstborn. And God told all the Hebrews before the plague, you need to put the blood over your house doorpost, and the angel of death will pass over you. So if there wasn't blood on the doorpost, your firstborn male child would be killed. And so they would recognize this, that it was a symbol of cleansing. So if you weren't covered by the blood, the angels of death would kill you. Also, the hyssop was used to sprinkle blood in ceremonial cleansings if a person had been touched or touched a dead body, been around a dead body. If you're healed from leprosy, again, they would take the hyssop, dip it in blood, and sprinkle it on the people. So, as you see, David, when he was asked to be cleansed and purified with the hyssop, he was asked to be cleansed by the blood of Jesus. He may not have known it at that time, but that's what God was setting up by the use of hyssop and what, being covered by the blood. So when Hebrews saw hyssop, they thought of blood. So here again, purge me with hyssop, cover me with the blood, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. After that, he can go on and say, let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Now that seems a little funny. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Why am I going to rejoice that I have broken bones when I read that? Well, when I read it again, my bones were broken, but now I'm rejoicing. I'm rejoicing because of the cleansing and restoration. And he has a parallel in Psalm 32. When we talk about being our bones, or another way of putting it is our inward being. And in Psalm 32, verse 3, it says, for when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. This tells me, because he had broken bones, because his bones were wasting away, this was before Nathan came to him. So even though he had done these things, in his heart he knew he was wrong, but he did nothing until he was confronted. How many times do we keep our wrongs in until somebody confronts us or we're overcome by guilt? So, here again, he's not rejoicing that God broke his bones, but rather that God healed his broken bones. And remember, his broken bones were broken because of his sin. God's conviction weighed heavy on David until it broke his bones. Once David confessed his sins, then God could heal him. So again, confession always comes before restoration. So now that he's being restored, David goes on and says, hide your face from my sins and blot out all of my iniquities. Again, cleansing, confess and be cleansed. Verse 10, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Notice what David asked to be cleansed, his heart, as we talked about before. Again, it all begins in your heart. So, with a clean heart, he confessed it, and then he could say to God, create in me a clean heart, God. When you confess it, then God can clean your heart. So, with the right heart, your mind and spirit will follow. And only God can create this clean heart. Cast me not from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Notice David is not asking for his salvation, but the return of the joy of his salvation. Sin steals our joy. And not only that, sin grieves the Holy Spirit. And that's what he meant in verse 11. Take not your spirit from me. Or how we would say it in our language, remove the distance from us, God. And in Ephesians 4:30, it talks about grieving the Holy Spirit. And it has a whole list. Do you have anger? I'm not going to run through them, but are you harboring anger? Are you harboring bitterness? These things grieve the Holy Spirit or put a distance between God and us. So part of his restoration, he was saying, cast not away from your presence and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Remove the distance from us, God. And again, restore the joy of your salvation. He wants his joy back. And once he has this, then he can go to verse 13. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. When fully restored, God can use us. So here again, confess, restoration, and then we can be used by God. And that's what we go to then, renewal and praise. for that renewal, we can be used by God, and as a result of that, we want to praise God. Verse 14. Deliver me from blood guiltness, O God. O God of my salvation, my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. Here again, deliver me from the blood guiltness. He was guilty of shedding the blood of Uriah. So he was guilty of that and deserved death, but God in his mercy didn't do that. And for that, he sang righteousness. And then finally, the last two verses, or a couple verses I'm going over. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. Once we've confessed, been restored, our spirit is renewed. As a result of that, we want to praise God because our heart is right. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. Now, we need to kind of put this all together. And this is why I did Psalm 50, 51. These are two of my favorite verses. And you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. And you will not despise. Now, there's some good stuff here. David knew the penalty of sin for the shedding of blood. He knew that he was guilty of murder, and he too should have been killed. But he also knew that the penalty of sin was shedding of blood. That was the purpose of the Old Testament sacrificial system. Leviticus 17 tells us, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it for you. I have given it for you on the altar to make atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that makes atonement by the life." So, since the life is in the blood, when a man takes another man's life, he is guilty of taking that life, and God demands blood. And also, this is confirmed in Hebrews. Indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. This is why God in the Old Testament set up sacrificial system. So when we are guilty of sin and we deserve to die, obviously we can't die. So God allowed them to do animal sacrifices, and that would cover their sins. And that was, the intent was to show them where their heart should be. So when it says God does not delight in the ritual of sacrifice. God delights in the sacrifice of a contrite or crushed heart. Remember we just talked about the crushed bones or being crushed on the inside? When we sin, or in a state of sin, we have that conviction on our heart. So what's it mean to have a broken spirit or the crushed bones? It means, going back to verse 3 and 4, it means recognizing and confessing that I was born into sin. It means that recognizing my sin is ever before me. It means recognizing that my sin separates me from God. David recognized this through the Holy Spirit. We can see this not only from Psalm 51, but from the words of Jesus. This is what Jesus meant when he spoke in Matthew 5. Come on. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. Parallel that with what Jesus says in Matthew, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." God hasn't changed. It was the same in the Old Testament as it is in the New Testament. That blessed are the poor in spirit. And when he's talking that, that's also what David was saying when, so I don't have to go back. Where are you? The sacrifices of, you will not delight in the sacrifice or I would give it. You are not pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Blessed are the poor in spirit. When we understand our brokenness, that's when we can be blessed. David recognized his brokenness. Blessed are those who mourn. And that word mourn, mean, when you go back in context in the original language, means mourning for your sin or mourning for the sins of others. So, here again, you do not delight in sacrifice. He delights in a broken heart. Just by going through the motions of putting a dead body on the altar does not delight God. But having a broken heart, and as a result that you give the sacrifice, that is what God is looking for. So God has not changed. In the Old Testament, God was looking forward to the cross of the blood of Jesus covering the sins. Today, we can look back at the cross and see the blood of Jesus covering our sins. And remember, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. So God's plan has been the same from the very beginning. It's the blood of Jesus, and it's only the blood of Jesus that can cover the sin of man. And because David's sins was covered, David declares, "O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare praise to you." Okay. And we're told the same in Hebrews 13 says, "Let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name." So, David offered up a sacrifice of praise. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. And because of that, then he can say, "O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise." He knew his sins was covered. His heart was right. He didn't just put the sacrifice on the altar. He changed his heart. And when we read in Hebrews, "Let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise," this is our praise. This is our sacrifice to God too. Our sacrifice of praise is when we acknowledge who Jesus is. And our life should be a sacrifice of praise. What I'm saying is, we all need to confess that Jesus covers our sin, but we just don't do that on Sunday. We do that on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. That is our sacrifice of praise, because God has wiped away our sins. Our sacrifice of praise means I keep that in my mind and in my heart when I go to work on Monday and how I interact with people, not just on Sunday when people see me at church. It means I take that back to my school, and when somebody says something nasty about me, I don't retaliate. I let God sort that out. That is our sacrifice of praise. So, let's put it all together. What's our application? David had this very deep sin. Nathan came to him and confronted him. He did not repent until he was confronted. Once confronted, he confessed his sin. He asked for restoration. He was restored and went forth. So what's that mean for us today? Sometimes we need a Nathan in our life. And you need to have somebody in your life that you give permission to be a Nathan to, and you to be a Nathan to them. You need somebody in your life to hold you accountable. When, I've had various jobs. When I worked in Sydney, we came from Cornerstone Sydney. There's a brother from Cornerstone Sydney that I met with on a weekly basis, and we would pray for each other and our families. And I gave him permission to be my Nathan. You need a Nathan in your life. another personal application. After I left that job, I had a traveling job. And at first I took it because it wasn't bad. I'd be on the road 2-3 times a month, no big deal. As the job progressed, I was on the road 2-4 times a week. And we were doing Bible study, and we stopped doing Bible study because I was on the road all the time. And another brother who was a Nathan to me that was in our Bible study says, "Hey, Brent, we haven't done lunch for a while. Let's do lunch." So don't judge me. We went to the Waffle House. And we're catching up on each other. And the only thing I was talking about was my job, 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 job. And my friend said, looked at me square in the eye and says, "Brent, you've lost your identity in Christ. Your job is your identity." He was my Nathan. I prayed about that, and I resigned from that job because it was holding me away from, leading me away from God. So you need a Nathan in your life. You also need the humility of David when Nathan comes to you. Nobody likes hearing you're a sinner. Nobody likes saying, you know, when David confronted him, how angry was it? "This man deserves to die." Until he said, "You are that man." Think of the humility it took David to accept that. He's the king of Israel. People live or die by his word. And Nathan comes to the king and says, "You deserve to die." And he had it took him humility, just as it took myself humility when my Nathan said to me, "Brent, you've lost your identity in Christ." It also means sometimes, I'll tell you what it's supposed to say that I messed up. Sometimes you need to be a Nathan. And you can only be a Nathan because you have a relationship with that brother or sister. I'm not saying, "Well, I don't like what you posted on Facebook, so, you know, I'm going to go get in your face." That's not what I'm saying. Since you gave that person permission to be your Nathan, he's given you permission to be his Nathan too. Sometimes you need to be a Nathan. My brother that I met with on a regular basis, all we needed to do when we came together, we knew each other so well, I could look in his eyes and it's like, "Okay, brother, what'd you do? Okay, Brent." And then we would talk about it and pray. Sometimes that was me. He would look at me and say, "What'd you do, Brent?" He could just tell by looking in my eyes. Sometimes you need to be a Nathan. So what's this mean in light of Psalm 51? It means, as a Christian, if the Holy Spirit convicts you of sin, you need to do as what David did in Psalm 51. You need to confess your sin. You need to be obedient to what God is calling and has already placed conviction on your heart. You need to be cleansed. Remember, the beginning of cleansing is confession, because you can't be clean until you bring it forth to God. And then finally, to live your life as a sacrifice of praise. So what's it mean for us? Just what I said. Confess your sin, ask to be cleansed from your sin, and restored, and walk in joy. That's for us as Christians too. But if you've never asked Jesus to cover you from your sin, it's still the same. You need to confess your sinfulness. So if you've never asked Jesus to cover your sins, allow him to crush your heart. You need to confess that you're a sinner, ask him to cover you. So, of course, if you'd like to come back up. At this time of the service, I'm going to read over the psalm again. And I'd like you to reflect as we do. And if God has convicted you of something that you need to confess, to be restored and be cleansed, please do that so you can have the joy of your salvation again. If you've never experienced the joy of salvation, now's the time to do it. We have open communion anytime. If God convicts you and you want to be cleansed, if you are a Christian and in right standing with your home church, the communion table is open for you at any time. But let me read this one last time. And if God's convicting you, confess it. And then Corey will play a song and we'll be done. Have mercy on me, God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore the joy of your salvation and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltness, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you do not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with burnt offering, but the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise.